I'm Eric Schmidt, and this is Video Voters Guide, a service of the League of Women Voters, a 100-year-old nonpartisan organization that believes democracy depends on informed and active participation. For more election information, be sure to visit our online site, Vote411. That's V-O-T-E 411, before you mark your ballot for the May 19th Oregon primary. One of the candidates on the May 19th Oregon primary ballot is John Verbeek. He is a candidate for the Republican Party's nomination for the United States Senate. Mr. Verbeek, thank you for joining us. We really appreciate it.
Glad to be here.
Good. We can hear you. We can see you. So let me ask you to tell our voters a little bit about yourself and why you are seeking the Republican Party nomination for the U.S. Senate.
Well, I've lived in Oregon 25 years. I think it's a beautiful state. I believe in Oregon and in freedom. And that's why I'm running. I think we have too much government control of the economy in Oregon. It's a long-term trend. And it's we need to reverse that. It's a simple concept, but not so easy to do. So that's why I'm running.
Are you at all concerned about the government control over the U.S. economy during a coronavirus pandemic?
Well, it's quite a response. The CARES Act, it's the government doesn't have any money. So the money comes from the taxpayers. So that's $13,000 per taxpayer. It put the Jobs Act of a few years ago, it poisoned it. We need to deal with it, but I hope the medicine doesn't kill the patient.
Had you been a member of the United States Senate during these particular votes, would you have voted for those packages, those economic stimulus packages?
I probably would have. Yeah.
Because you think we need to have that kind of response.
I don't know if there were any hearings about it. The worldwide response to that virus, it was just amazing to me. All the countries, it's almost like a controlled response through the media. There have been other big viruses with the Mexican flu. This SARS virus has been around for a while. It's a very aggressive form. But you have to keep things in perspective. The flu killed 30,000 people. 50,000 people are killed in car accidents. So I find the response quite... I wish there would be a little bit more hearings, but it's people losing their job. You know, you need to pay bills. So in case of an emergency, then I probably would have voted for it. But how do we get out of it? How do we pay the taxpayers on the hook for $13,000, each U.S. taxpayer? That's a lot of money.
Well, that leads me to my next question. If you are elected to the U.S. Senate, what do you think should be prioritized to help your constituents, Oregonians, Americans, deal with the ongoing and wide-ranging impacts that are going to affect healthcare and projections for the environment and all of the things that are bound up in the economy? What would be your priority?
I have three goals. One is limited government. It's been a long-term trend. If you add up all your bills, your income tax, federal income tax, your water bill, the tax for my car, $190. If you add it all up, then the government controls quite a bit of the economy. I would say about 40%. Compared to maybe less than 10% 100 years ago. So we need to limit that government growth. That's the one item. And then the second theme is constitutional rights, the right to privacy against unreasonable searches, religious freedom. Very important to uphold those rights in any legislation. And if we do, some bills just won't get passed that help with the budget deficit. And the last item is a simple concept, but very hard to do. It's not easy. And that is more people need to pay their own bills. It's one thing to pay for national issues like our military. I have no problem paying the government to to have a strong military, but when we come to when it comes to redistributing income, that some people get money from other taxpayers for whatever it is, if it's for healthcare or student loans, or even the electric car of my neighbor, that's we should be more careful with that. So it's just a gradual process, but if we apply those, that will help Oregonians because it will mean more freedom for them. And that's what I'm concerned about, that we don't need so much government to tell us what to do and more important, what we cannot do.
I think it's safe to say that extreme levels of political polarization have created a toxic atmosphere in Washington, D.C. What steps are you going to take if you are elected to work with members of the opposite party, with people who don't agree with you necessarily politically or ideology, to get needed legislation passed?
It's very important to keep lines of communication open. That's true in a marriage and also in Congress. But in Oregon, we should not point the fingers to Washington, D.C. Look at our own legislature in Salem. It's even worse. Republicans had to walk out to stop some horrific legislation. I think it's important when you have controversial issues that you don't try to ram it through. And then because that's not sustainable in the long end. So if something is controversial, we should work more towards consensus and not the party in power just ram things through. And there's no sustainability in that. So I'm in it for the long-term solutions that we can sustain, and then based on limited government, upholding constitutional rights, and then revenue neutral. So with that redistribution of income, if we have any new taxes, that we cut it else. So those would be my priorities.
The effects of an economic recession are already being felt most strongly by the most vulnerable in our society. What kind of policies do you support, or would you support in the event that you're elected, to ensure the health and well-being of those who have the least resources to help themselves?
It's important we have public policy that encourages activity. Some people are just not able to function. If you're on severely disabled, in a wheelchair, there's limited to what you can do, but we have programs for those. But we have there's a lot of people who get benefits, and they should be able to stand on their own feet more. And so it's a gradual process. The government is to encourage activity, make laws that promotes initiative and doing things, and not expecting the government will be paying you, because the government doesn't have any money. What you're basically saying is that your neighbor and people down the street are paying your bill, and that is not right.
We have about a minute left, so I'd like to give you an opportunity to make your case to the viewers of this video voters guide. How are you distinguishable against the other candidates for the Republican Party nomination for the U.S. Senate? What makes you stand out, and why should they vote for you?
Well, the case for limited government, upholding constitutional rights, and especially also the distribution mechanism of the government to say no, but do it gradually. Voters should be thinking about that more before they cast their vote, and who they think is the candidate who is the most collegiate, let me say it that way, to come to reasonable solutions.
John Verbeek is a candidate for the Republican Party nomination for the United States Senate. Mr. Verbeek, thank you so much for joining us. I really appreciate the opportunity to talk to you today.
My pleasure. Thank you, Eric.
And thank you. And thank you to all of you who tuned in. Don't forget, vote 411 and learn more about your personalized ballot information from the League of Women Voters. I'm Eric Schmidt. Thanks for watching.